this week that I was preaching on feeling overwhelmed, she offered to come and lie across the altar as a poster child for this time of the year. I know many of you are still in that phase of life, like me, when it feels like there are never enough hours in the day, despite the extra hour that we got last night. And I applaud you all for being here on time this morning. With classes, jobs, and sometimes growing families, there is little time just to relax and to be. Some of us are running around like headless chickens. I'll be the first to admit that that describes my life. And it's often rare that I let grief or anxiety even catch up with me. I don't have time for so many emotions and so many deep experiences. I'm on the run. I've got to go. And I know some of you can relate to that. Others have entered a phase of life with fewer daily obligations, where you are perhaps no longer a slave to a jam-packed schedule. But that doesn't mean that you don't feel overwhelmed with thoughts and emotions, expectations and longings. We pray for our loved ones who are still in the washing machine of life. And we pray for ourselves as our health takes surprising and sometimes painful turns. We must admit that we can no longer always do what we once did or what we would like to do. And we grieve. Everyone grieves, no matter our age, our stage in life, our physical, mental, or emotional health and well-being. There are times when each of us has had enough, when we have had it up to here, and sometimes up to here with everything that life has to offer, when we feel like we're struggling just to keep our head above water. There are times when I feel that way that I think and I daydream what it must be like to stop, to just let go, to get off of that wild rat race and just take a nap. Have any of you ever just taken a nap? It's amazing that the world never stops when I take a nap. It's great. I had a spiritual director once who said that the holiest thing that many of us could ever do is to take a nap. And in this world today, especially in this country, we are forever encouraged to give and do and perform more, to up our output, to increase our productivity, to make more money so we can spend more money, so we can buy more things that we then have to clean, and then we have to store them, and we have to maintain them, and rinse and repeat over and over. There is so little respect in this country for rest and for self-care that some of us who practice rest and self-care feel like we have to apologize or explain why it was that we needed a nap or that special time away. But have you ever noticed what happens in your life when tragedy strikes? When a natural disaster erupts? When someone you love dies? Or when some life-altering news bomb is dropped? It seems like time stands still. And depending on our generation, we can remember exactly where we were when President Kennedy was assassinated, or when those twin towers fell. Those are corporate experiences that usher in our grief, but many of us have individual experiences that are just as strong or stronger than those. We remember the exact moment when we learned of a particular loved one's death, of some terrible health diagnosis, or of a tragic loss. It is in those moments that many people, even those with little or no faith, turn to a higher power for wisdom and guidance. When life doesn't make sense, when there is no resolution with certain news or realities, then we turn to some form of God for comfort and help. And our God is an expert in our realities, in our pleasures and in our pains, in our broken hearts and in our shattered dreams. When our lives crash against the rocky cliffs, we twist in horror and we reach out to God. And there we find, just as we found today in Psalms 23, that God is there, always has been, always will be, simply waiting for us to turn and see. To turn and see, and when we choose to turn, what a glorious sight that we encounter, waiting patiently For us to remember how loved we are, we find the Lord as our shepherd, lovingly longing to gather us in, reminding us that in God we want for nothing. We are no longer prisoners to our consumeristic drives. We do not need or want anything outside of the connection with our divine Creator, who is light and love, hope and healing incarnate. And what does God do with our brokenness, our pain, and our grief? The Lord makes us lie down in green pastures and leads us beside still waters. The Lord knows and accepts us just as we are, ramped up, freaking out, totally hopeless, and invites us to rest and to embrace stillness. This is the power of prayer, of meditation, and mindfulness. When was the last time you lied in the green grass? I know this fall when my husband was raking up leaves, there was a big pile for Lillian to jump in, and I took a moment to lie down in a patch of green that hasn't yet died in our front yard. And I took a few deep breaths, and I could feel my entire body relax into that soft earth. It felt so much better than my yoga mat or the thick carpet here in the prayer room that I pray on every week. It felt like I was being welcomed, and I could smell that smell of the earth, and I looked up into the skies, and I could see the bright bluebird day, the Colorado bluebird day, and I thought, this is what it feels like to be restored. It only lasted for a minute before my four-year-old jumped on top of me and then my eight-month-old crawled over to get on top as well. But for a minute, I was reminded of the power in lying down in green pastures. And it also reminded me of my older brother when I was growing up, because I was a bit of a theater geek, a theater nerd, and he used to call me a hippie tree hugger and make fun of all those tree huggers. But I think those tree huggers might be onto something. So if you haven't lied down in the grass lately, or you haven't put your arms around something living like a tree, I challenge you to do that and see what happens with your soul. I love the way that the 23rd Psalm places God in the active role. With everything that I have to do, I appreciate not being the leader in this relationship. I'm not leading my own life. I only have to keep my eyes focused on God. And God leads us in the paths towards righteousness or right living. We don't have to look for the trail markers or discern our way forward. We don't have to plan the timing and the method. All we have to do is trust and follow God. When I'm counseling others or sitting with people in pain, I quote verse 4 of the 23rd Psalm more often than any other verse. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. My friend Caitlin Elmore is a chaplain in this area, and I asked for her expertise when I was planning today's sermon. What scripture did she find most powerful to use when working with people in grief? And she said the 23rd Psalm. And I thought, oh brother, it's one of the most well-known psalms in the book. It's really hard to find something new and exciting to say about it. And she said, remind your congregation that that psalm is not just written for the one who has died, but also for those of us who are living and who are trying to deal with our grief and our pain and our loss. And reading the psalm over and over this week, that gave me a new perspective. When our hope is lost and when death overcomes us and darkness seems to cloud out the sun, we have to keep walking. Even if it's just baby steps, yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Because when we sit down, when we give up and we get stuck, that's when that tidal wave of feeling overwhelmed washes over us and threatens to drown us. Sure, we need times of rest. We need to take a nap sometimes. But when the going gets really tough, we also need to gently keep going. Baby steps. Walking forward. Caitlin told me, well, she was the keynote speaker at a UMC youth conference this weekend called Ignite up in Buckhorn, and she told me when I asked about her expertise that there was a story and a book that I should read. The story was about her own life. A few weeks ago, the power went out in her house. She was in her bedroom, and her candles and flashlights were on the other end of the house. And so she was afraid, and she woke up and put her arms out in front of her, and vulnerably was stumbling around in the darkness, waiting to trip or fall or get hurt, on guard. Even though it was her home, which is a safe place, it was somehow made dangerous and foreboding in the darkness of night. And she said that experience reminded her of something she'd read in a book by Barbara Brown Taylor, who is a retired Episcopalian priest. In 2014, her book, Learning to Walk in the Dark, which I haven't read yet, but I did order on Amazon this week, that book says, "Those of us who wish to draw near to God should not be surprised when our vision goes cloudy, for this is a sign that we are approaching the opaque splendor of God. If we decide to keep going beyond the point where our eyes or minds are any help to us, we may finally arrive at the pinnacle of the spiritual journey toward God, which exists in complete and dazzling darkness." It's a whole new way to think about the imagery of darkness and light, which many of us are familiar with. I love Caitlin's story. I love this quote from Reverend Taylor, because I agree that walking through life and grief and loss is just like walking in the dark. We have to open ourselves up to vulnerability. We have to not pretend like we're okay when we're not okay. It's okay to not be okay for a little while, but we have to be honest about how we are if we want to get to where God is leading us to be. We have worries and fears even as we take those first few tentative baby steps. But we also have faith, a faith that is centuries long, a faith that is a strong foundation that we can lean on. We may not have all the answers or understand the path we're on, or even clearly know what destination it is that we're headed for. All we have to do is trust that God is with us, comforting us and protecting us. And then we must fear no evil. We walk in cloudy darkness with the faith that God will lead us back into the light of hope and joy at some point. And we baby step it each day, knowing that we are never alone. God goes before us, clearing the path and beckoning us to follow. And we walk alongside others whom we have allowed into our darkness, others whom we share our lives with, who listen to our pain, who pray for us, and who patiently trust that we will, slowly but surely, make our way back into the light. When we submit to God, when we follow our shepherd, then the outcome is no surprise. God prepares a banquet for us in the presence of our enemies. God rewards our decisions and our tenacity to take those first few painfully difficult steps in faith. And God anoints our heads with oil. "Well done, my good and faithful servant." These words are spoken for us even when we fail, even when we backslide, even when we lose our faith or our way in life. God prepares us for the greater paths and the challenges ahead, all while overflowing our cups with blessedness and calls for celebration. You see, even when life throws us curveballs or tries to choke us out with lemons, surely goodness and mercy are with us through every heart-aching, gut-wrenching moment of grief, pain, and feeling overwhelmed. And then and now, we will dwell in the house of the Lord, in the darkness of a house without power or energy, in the darkness of the dazzling splendor and presence of God, in the light, in the lightness of a house filled with holiness forever. You know, I was thinking about God's house this week, and I thought, sometimes I feel like I'm in the master suite, you know, with the clawfoot tub and the jets inside. And sometimes when I'm in God's house, I feel like Cinderella in that little dirty attic place up in the top, or like Harry Potter in that tiny little closet squeezed underneath the stairs. exactly you find yourself within God's house. What we can trust in and know is that if we remain in God, then God will remain in us. And walking slowly through grief with God is a choice, just like feeling alone and overwhelmed and stuck in our lives is also a choice. Sure, our circumstances ebb and flow, darkness and grief creep in and settle down, but it's our choice to choose whether or not we thank them for coming and for teaching us something about ourselves and our lives and then sending them on their way, or if we invite that heavy weight, that burden in, and we welcome them into our hearts and our homes, we invite them to move in and take over and become our masters. The choice is ours. So as for you and your house today, will you choose to serve and follow God?